I'd like to introduce you to our next panelist, Janet Austin. Janet is the Chief Executive Officer of the YWCA of Metro Vancouver, and Janet will tell you a little bit more about what that organization is. But she's responsible for one of BC's largest and most diversified nonprofit organizations. And they deliver services, really important services, to tens of thousands of people every year across Vancouver, Metro Vancouver. Janet herself has worked in so many different areas and with so many different populations of people. She's developed housing for seniors and families, as well as transition housing for women who are in need of a safe place, homeless shelters, group homes for people of disabilities with disabilities. So you get a sense of what Janet's interested in. She's admired by many as an extraordinary leader. Janet has won many awards. But if you ask Janet herself, who are you? She'll tell you, I'm just a community volunteer. Please welcome Janet Austin.
So as Maria said, I'm a community volunteer, and I'm responsible for a large charitable organization that is inclusive of all faiths and all cultures. So in Canada, we are a very wealthy country, but despite that, we still have many people who live in poverty and many children who live in poverty. So our vision, the vision of my organization, is to create greater equality in society. So greater equality between men and women, less disparity between rich and poor. And we believe that the best path to a better world is by providing the best possible start to our youngest citizens, children. So these are our goals as an organization, and we work to accomplish those goals in a number of ways. As Maria mentioned, we provide a very broad array of services to thousands and thousands of people every year. So that's men, women, and children, but mostly we work with mothers and their children. So we provide things like food and clothing, housing and legal assistance, childcare and support for single mothers, assistance with education and employment, and also health and physical fitness, including things like yoga and meditation. So we rely on science and research to shape our ideas about how we can change social conditions. And we work very hard to put the knowledge that comes from science into action in the way we deliver our programs. Our most ambitious advocacy has been to engage political leaders, government leaders, in understanding why it is important, why we would all benefit if we invest more in the development of children and if we do more for young children. So Kim has given us some very good news about the work that's underway in BC, work that we're all engaged in, and that work has been done obviously with the leadership of people like Kim, but the support of people like Tamara, who's sitting beside me, who is a well-known business leader and whose organization sets an amazing example of generosity in the community. But Kim has also reminded us that we have work to do. And when we look at the early development instrument, the results of that, the data that comes from that, we see that for children at age 5, there are still far too many children who have difficulties at that age. So although our work in schools is essential and it's coming along very well, we know that we actually also need to look at what's going on for children in the family and in the community before they go to school. So in Canada, there is very good work happening at many levels, but in Canada, we don't do as much as some other countries do to support families when they're raising young children. But we do something that I think is very important. It's a special program. And when children are born, we allow parents to take time off from work to stay at home with their new infants. Okay. So parents can take up to a full year, and employers are required to hold their jobs for them. Parents are entitled to apply for a benefit, which gives them some income, so they have a way to support their family during the year that they are at home with children. Now, this time can be split equally between fathers and mothers, but what we see overwhelmingly is that it's taken by mothers. Now, this isn't very surprising because I think in most societies, we tend to think of the care of infants as being primarily the responsibility of mothers. That's not very surprising at all. But recent science tells us that this is perhaps something that we should question. So there's good scientific evidence that demonstrates that when fathers play a role in caring for children, they're healthier and happier, it's good for children, and also our communities benefit. There's also been some very interesting research recently by neuroscientists that demonstrates that when fathers are the primary caregivers or the major caregivers, something happens to their brains. Their brains actually change and they become more like mothers. So they become less aggressive and they become more patient. There's also evidence.
They can actually eventually be able to feed the baby.
Well, I'm you know, that's a good point, and I'm just getting to that because there's actually another study that shows that when fathers spend at least 2 days a week with their children and they do those tasks, they feed the baby, they put the baby to bed, they change the baby's diapers, that what happens is that those fathers go on to raise children which are very compassionate, right? So, so it seems that science is telling us that there's something very positive in the example of a nurturing father as well as a nurturing mother, and we need to understand that better and encourage that. So in my work, and Tamara sees this as well, I see many young men who would like to take time to be at home with their new babies. And even though we encourage that at my workplace and in other workplaces, we see that young men are reluctant to do this because they fear disapproval. They fear the disapproval of society. They fear the disapproval of their peers and their coworkers. And they worry that people will think that they are less masculine. Now, I've heard you say that you think women should play a greater role in society. And I think that's a very good idea, right? But what I wonder about is whether men should also play a greater role in the domestic sphere and with the care of children. And if they did, would this help to develop the qualities of compassion and empathy in children, but also in men? And might it also lead us to a more peaceful world? It might make these qualities of compassion and empathy, what you would call warm-heartedness, more generally respected by society overall. So, Your Holiness, I think you are a person who likes children very much. So I wonder...
if you might just Jean, more from my father,
yes,
then I will be more aggressive. For short temper. If Jean,
yeah,
from my mother, then very, very warm-hearted, compassionate person.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So, so perhaps my own sort of case,
yeah.
I think early period, I follow my father's sort of way, short temper. Then later, I follow my mother, very compassionate.
So, so I wonder if your father cared for you and changed your diapers and fed you. I wonder if that might have made him more like your mother. No? What do you think of that?
I don't know. I don't know. As it is, I think the importance of the field to further experiment.
Research. Yeah, right. Right. When you're
then I want to fully support the women, female. Should take more responsibility in the society. Here, you see, I, since many years, I tell him or appeal him when I give public talk, in the society, concept of leadership in very, very early human sort of history. No leadership, no concept of leadership, but all work together. Then a very small population. Then gradually, farming system developed. Population increase. Then some mischievous people, it is start. Because of the farming system or other sort of more because of sophisticated life, then they mine. This is my land, my thing, my possession. Then concept of stealing, thief, or bully. These things happen. So concept of leadership come. At that time, no rule of education. So in order to become a leader, the physical strength is the main factor, like other animals. So therefore, biologically, physically, is the father or male more stronger. So the male dominance then start. Even some cultural heritage. I think except one small island in Pacific, one occasion, you see, someone you see mentioned, in that small island, mother take the main responsibility.
Leadership.
Leadership. In the family and eventually in the society.
The matriarchal society. Matriarchal society.
Oh. Except that, I think usually, you see, male more dominance, even religion, male dominance there, because of the cultural heritage of the existing society at that time. So, then education start. Education brings more equal, male to female. Now they are the youngest now, Nobel laureate, the
Malala.
I think she really make effort, you see, education, the Chikpa quality.
The equal education.
Wonderful. So education brings more sort of
equality.
But still, the society, still male dominance, still there. So now time come. General education, not adequate. So education about heart, warm heart, affection, now becomes something important. In that respect, female, biologically, more potential concern of other pains. Again, now scientists, you see, experimented. It shows. And even birds, other animals, the mother take full care. Father, enjoy short moment, then forget. We human being better, little better. So therefore, the now time come. Female should take more active role regarding promotion of human compassion, human love. So that's as you mentioned. I don't know. Is the father become like mother? That I don't know. but the mother should take more active role. And if father not follow mother's sort of pattern, they give some punishment. Usually I tease you, so some my friend, you see, in their home, one boss, that's wife. So some boss, very aggressive, that's good, disciplinary action.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.